All right, welcome, webmakers. It's the Mozilla Webmaker call for Tuesday, May 29th. Before we throw over to Heather Payne, who's going to tell us what Hive Toronto has planned for the Global Weekend of Code on June 23rd, I just direct your attention to line 92 of the Etherpad. I don't know if some of you heard, we launched some stuff last week. We launched Mozilla Webmaker. We launched Summer Code Party. And the press paid attention and picked up a lot of our talking points, which is really nice to see. So some of the highlights of the press coverage are in line 97 and below. And people have been adding some feedback and anecdotes they heard from last week. Let's see. I guess one request we got from Mozilla Japan, I don't know, Ryan, if you know the answer to this, was for a subtitled version, and I wasn't sure if we'd already started a version of the video on universal subtitles.
I don't think we have, and I also think that Mozilla.org is now set up to support it, so we could activate it on the video that's on the page.
Great.
So we should do that.
Great idea.
Cool. Any other feedback from folks on last week's launch? R7 to unmute. Some folks are saying that people kind of got the name, they felt they could relate to it. And that was one thing that really stood out is, you know, especially in the press coverage, is everybody seemed to get this fundamental idea, like that talking point of moving people from using the web to making the web. Like, you know, we've been repeating that internally for months. But it seemed like people outside our bubble actually kind of get it and use it, which was nice validation. Cool. We'll continue adding feedback to the pad if you have any other feedback on last week's launch. But let's push ahead. And Heather Payne, what can you tell us about what you've got cooking for the June 23rd Global Weekend of Code?
Hey, everybody. Can you hear me?
Yep.
So yeah, we're having a big event for the Summer Code Party in Toronto. It's on June 23rd. And I've just been plugging away. We've got some really cool organizations involved, and I just wanted to share a bit about our plan for that day. So we have 7 stations, as you can see from the Eventbrite page that I shared. Cool organizations like TVO Kids and TIFF. Maker Kids is a really cool one here in Toronto. They're going to be doing a toy hacking station. So for anyone in Toronto, we are taking toy donations, and kids are going to be like pulling legs and arms out of toys and putting them into other toys and taking voice boxes from toys and putting them in the other. And then the cool thing is that we're really encouraging a lot of collaboration between these 7 stations. So for example, once you make a toy at the toy hacking station, you could take it over to the TIFF station and create a stop motion animation with your toy. And then you can go over to the Mozilla Thimble station and create a web page about it. Or you can take it to the Gamer Camp station where you can hack a Scratch game and make your toy the character instead of whatever one that comes with the program. So that's going really well. Everyone's super excited. This is part of a larger effort here in Toronto to sort of see if there's some interest in having a Hive Toronto learning network here. So this is sort of like our test run. You know, do we all like working together? Do we like putting on events together? Do kids love it? And we're just going to see how it goes. So I'm happy to like take any questions people have as they're planning their own events, because this is obviously this is the second Hive Toronto pop-up that we've done here in Toronto. And then personally, I've done like at least, I don't know, 25 workshops around tech in the past year. So I'm happy to like answer people's questions about that. In terms of the plan for launching, so we are going to hopefully launch it today, the registration page. And I have a couple things I know I need to change with regards to the communications. I'm going to look for those and change them. And then, yeah, signing people up over the next 3 weeks or so, and then just in behind the scenes making sure the event is ready to go.
Cool. And Heather, I see there's a parent zone. Can you tell us a bit about what the parent zone is all about?
Oh, yeah. So rather than dealing with some of the headaches around parents dropping their kids off, which, you know, definitely can be done, but without having, you know, police checks on all of the instructors and things like that, it can be a little bit risky. So rather than dealing with that, we've decided to make it so that parents do have to stay. And we're setting up for them a separate parent zone so that kids can feel free to explore on their own, not have to hang out with their parents all day, but also so that parents can do some interesting stuff too. So we're going to have them obviously talk to Mark Sermon and get some of his thoughts on why this stuff is very important. We're going to do a panel with some people with interesting tech careers and just sort of get some questions going and get a bit of a forum happening. And then also have some different sort of stations set up just with one computer sort of spread around where the parents themselves can try out all of the different tech that the kids are learning during the day. And so, yeah, the parent zone I find is really important also because we do sort of want parents to like be there during the day so that we can make sure that they sort of get on board with the fact that this stuff is important and that they can maybe encourage their kids to work on it at home too.
Fantastic. So there's questions on the pad under line 165. What's the target age range that you're looking for?
Oh yeah, I need to add that. Let me make a note. I need to add that to the Eventbrite page. So we're targeting, I would say, 8 to 12, 9 to 13, maybe 8 to 13 type of age group. But I want to add a reference to the fact that this is really designed to be fun for the whole family. So older siblings and younger siblings should definitely come along because there will be things, activities that will appeal to them. And you know, you can always find ways to make an activity fun for a kid who's older or younger. For example, at the last Hive pop-up in February, we found that the paper prototyping station was really important because it's a really good catch-all for the younger siblings, as well as being fun for kids who want to, you know, design iPad apps or start creating wireframes. But any kid can have some fun with, like, cardboard paper and markers and stuff like that. So, yeah. And then I do, like, in response to the question about Hive Toronto, we're basically just using this event as like a test to see whether we want to do a Hive Toronto or not. So we decided to keep the messaging out of it. Everyone who's involved has been part of this sort of journey where we're exploring the idea together, but not ready to go public facing with that idea yet. We just want to make sure first.
Cool. And are you looking for volunteers in Toronto if people want to help out, Heather?
Yes. So I have a few needs. One is that the Mozilla station, I did send an email to Mozilla Toronto and didn't get any replies, except for two, actually, but I had to follow up with them in person. So if people from Mozilla Toronto want to help with the WebPageMaker symbol station, we really need you. We need someone to run the station as well. Like, we need someone to say, like, here's what we're going to be teaching here, and, you know, it's free form, and but we still need someone to sort of be the champion of it. So please email me. Maybe we can just add my email somewhere. And let me know if you want to get involved with that. And then the other stations need volunteers as well. If someone wants to run a registration table, I'd love to have you. Otherwise, I'll be asking people specifically. And a couple of the other stations need help too. Scratch needs a few people. So if someone knows Scratch really well, let me know. And then also would really like to – so we do – the one thing that we learned in February was that documentation is super important, and it needs to happen the day of as well as afterward. So we do have a separate documentation station that's being run by the Toronto Public Library. And so we'll be having like a Tumblr that's being updated throughout the day. People will be tweeting out their photos throughout the day. And I also want to have a videographer at that station. So if, it doesn't need to be professional. So if somebody feels like they want to take on that role, I would really love to talk to you as well. I mean, professional would be awesome, but like we have no budget, so like free is good.
Sounds good. So you're looking for help with, and I just want to make sure we got it down right, the Mozilla station, the registration table, the Scratch station, and the documentation station.
Yeah. And if like if you're just like excited about this whole thing, like just let me know. I just added my email there. So just reach out and let me know what you're interested in, because although we are definitely tight for space, there are things that need to be done. So.
Cool. So people seem to really love the idea of the toy hacking session, or asking whether this is a chance to bring like Arduino or hardware hacking or little bits into the mix.
Oh, right. So, you know, we're basically leaving it up to Maker Kids. That's the organization that's running the Toy Hacking Station. And they have done this a whole bunch of times with the toy hacking. We are doing something with LEDs and flashing eyes, which is an option for some of the older kids, which I think is Arduinos. They do use Arduinos for that. But at the same time, like, there's 7 stations going on, so I did suggest that, and they just like thought it was a little bit too complicated, given the fact that there's a lot going on during the day and lots of things for the kids to do. But yeah, there are LEDs, so that's cool.
Very cool. So you can put blinking like LED eyeballs inside like a doll's head kind of thing?
Yeah, they had a funny, doll's head, or they had a funny story about like a kid who made an evil turtle, stuff like that.
Very cool. Any final questions for Heather before we push ahead?
Oh, I see a question. Is there going to be popcorn? We did popcorn maker at the pop-up in February, and we decided that the format wasn't really ideal because it takes a little bit longer to create something cool with Popcorn Maker than the kids had time for or had the patience for. That being said, like, there might be a way to integrate it into the TIFF station if someone's really passionate about it. So let me know. We can definitely have like one person from Popcorn there to like, if any kid wants to do that, then I think there's definitely space for it. So let me know.
So it sounds like if there was a enthusiastic Toronto Popcorn volunteer, that would be a good way to get more popcorn into the session.
Yeah, totally.
Cool. Great. Well, thanks, Heather. So we're going to try to turn this into a blog post this week, and we'll really surface those areas where you're looking for participation. So if you have anything that you want to add to the pad to make it into the blog post, or maybe you can just have a quick look and make sure that what's here is roughly accurate, and we'll try to get that out in the next day or two.
Awesome. Thank you.
Any final questions or comments for Heather before we push ahead? Sounds like no. Thanks, Heather.
Thank you.
And let's push ahead to, I'm not sure if Mark, are you there? I know Mark was stuck in traffic in Berlin earlier.
Hello.
Hey, Mark. How are you?
Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Yeah. I'm on a cell phone speakerphone here in Berlin. So thanks, Matt. I just wanted to give a little bit of a very top-level set of impressions from the London Learning Labs, and then I'm going to let Aaron report out some more specifics. And I guess the big takeaway is really, really exciting. Let me back up and say what we did was 2 days of basically simple project development with set of community partners in London, the London Zoo, Radio Waves that does sports reporting on video with kids, and a whole bunch of just sort of local developers and hackers. And they were developing symbol projects like you guys have all seen on these calls, and you can see them in the links there in the Etherpad if you go to the Learning Lab project. And then we worked with Coder Dojo, all of these different partners coming together on Saturday to do playtesting, where we took the missions we developed on Thursday and Friday, and then tested them out with kids. And there's great photos up there that I'm actually looking at on Michelle's screen as we speak. So take a look at those. I think they're in the Etherpad as well. And the thing I wanted to really highlight that was very validating the work that everybody is doing here is that the partners, as well as just some sort of random folks who came wanting to hack and were curious, really within a day came up with the beginnings of quite compelling symbol projects. And that was exciting to me in terms of just seeing this idea that we have out there that if you just have a single web page and you try to build some instructional content in it, people will come up with surprising stuff and stuff that, as we found out in the playtesting, kids actually want to tinker with. And the London Zoo one, which is about remixing animals, and as a part of their conservation work on edge species and hybrid species, really, I think, worked very, very well with the kids. So I think we're going in the right direction, or we're onto something in terms of the combination of the gallery and the software. And it really is those two things that for the first time sort of out in the wild I saw coming together, and that was exciting. And I guess, you know, the other thing that is really, really worth saying is, had we done it, it kind of goes to Brett's point about popcorn in February versus popcorn in June in the Etherpad. Had we done this London Learning Lab 2 weeks earlier, it just wouldn't have worked, which is a huge testament to the Thimble team and the whole incredible amount of work that was done just the week before this. And then, you know, the Michelle and the learning team, Jess and Aaron and Chloe and John, all putting things together, being able to take advantage of that work that had been done on Thimble and on the software. So really an amazing example of kind of working together, and just amazing, amazing work by the team and by the developers. So for those of you who weren't there, Andrew was there from the developer side, but all of you guys who put Thimble together and who weren't there, I want to give you a huge round of applause and thank you. And both the kids and the partners in London really appreciated everything that you did. So I'm clapping here in Berlin. Aaron, do you want to talk about like what the actual outputs were and learnings and kind of next steps?
Sure. Yeah, so it was an awesome 2 days, and there's some links here on 197, 198 to show you kind of what we did and what we built. But it sort of highlights is that day one was, again, we just kind of put out a big call. We had some initial partners that we sort of seeded, but mostly it was general people that kind of saw the Eventbrite or through our network. And so people showed up on day one, and the whole idea was to show them the projects that we've developed and show them Thimble. And then the plan was to kind of really handhold them through day one to kind of help them come up with ideas, to do some paper prototyping, and then to move into day two, which was about implementation. But really, as Mark said, by the end of day one, we had most of the projects almost done, certainly completely concepted, and most of them already built working digital prototypes. So it was really, really impressive, and again, a huge testament to sort of the model of things that we're building, which we'll talk about in a second. But some of the highlights there from the results page, I definitely I encourage you to check them out. But so the London Zoo was one of the partners there, and they built a project basically allowing kids to or learners to remix pictures of various species and create their own species. And they do this by moving around HTML images and hacking the HTML on the page, and then they also can add their own kind of narration about describing that new species. So it's super high quality and still in development in terms of kind of final imagery, but the goal is to have it by the end of this week. So it's really, really compelling content. Also, Radio Waves, again, was there, as Mark mentioned, and they're doing a bunch of work around helping kids move from just fans of things to actually like reporting and kind of taking ownership of content. And so they're focusing on the Olympics. And so there's a project around getting kids to both kind of create their own little mini report about the Olympics as well as pull in a bunch of media that they find that's relevant and build media pages through Thimble. I guess one thing to note is that all the projects that were created are all Thimble projects. So they all sit on top of the two-pane editor and all involve hacking the HTML or CSS to complete the learning challenge. And then there's some other awesome ones. There's a zombie one, which is always cool. There's a bunny one where you have to save some bunnies and a bunch more. So definitely encourage people to check that out. Michelle Thorne has a write-up. There's one coming from me later today. And then there's the photos that we already mentioned. But really, like, to sort of pull this back a step, like, how does it tie into the bigger picture? There's several things here. So one is that really, like, our goal with a lot of the webmaker stuff is to create a movement and to get a bunch of people involved and not necessarily have Mozilla at the center of it all. And so that's both in terms of content. So we want to build some projects, but ultimately we want there to be lots of community contribution and lots of projects that are submitted, but then also in terms of, you know, teaching webmaking and evangelizing it. And so this event was really good for starting to build some of those ties and relationships, both with kind of the more formal organizations, but then also with a bunch of instructors on the ground in the UK. And we want to do a lot more stuff like this. And then on the content side, again, you know, we've built something like 8 or 10 missions to kind of kick all of this off, but ultimately we want there to be kind of missions, sorry, they're called projects. We want there to be projects that that sort of reflect all kinds of interest-based learning. So one of the little taglines that we had there was that was interest-based access for learners. So eventually we want any learner that comes to be able to find something that matters to them, something that they want to make, and in the process learn web-making skills. And so that really depends on having a lot of people contribute to that content. So this was another, again, a way to both get more content from the community, but then also look at that process and how and sort of test about how easy it is and how we need to scaffold the community to build things. And then finally around user testing. I mean, I think Jess would put in here practice what we preach, that really, like, you know, building around the community is in our kind of core design philosophy, and this allowed us to do that. And the fact that we were doing this early-ish in the process, you know, we had a big disclaimer at the beginning that, you know, all of this is brand new. Thimble is brand new and basically alpha, if that. And it's an opportunity to really kick the tires early on so that things that we see or the ideas that they have actually have an opportunity to get in there. So that was actually a huge success. People were really into that. You know, people weren't necessarily, they weren't frustrated if something broke. It was more about, like, excited to be in at that level of things. So those were kind of huge wins for us. And then moving into what we learned a lot, which is the short answer. But again, as Mark said, the fact that people could build these projects in one day, and these were not, so there were definitely developers there, but a lot of the people that dove in day one were not developers. And that, I think, was just a great thing to see because, you know, we sort of have this theory that these hackable one-page learning challenges are a low barrier to entry for people and a way that we can really scale this, but we had never really seen that in action. And so that was something that was great to learn, and we also learned a little bit about how to even support that process a little further, like helping people focus on learning objectives and really kind of scope things down. We also got some great feature requests and priorities from folks around ways that we might be able to improve Thimble moving forward. And one example is one was having feedback from within it, kind of like the Firefox happy bar or something where you can say this made me happy because or this made me sad because. Another one was being able to collapse or expand various sections of the code so that it's not just all out in front of you and you can kind of dive into the smaller kind of chunks of code where you need to. And let's see, what else? So again, learned a bunch about supporting the content and the tools, also about the event design. We really think this is an important type of event to really kind of help people dive into the learning content, get excited about what we're trying to do, form those relationships. So we're going to work on a kit to support them. And then also, again, the relationship side of things was great. And it turned out that our last day of the event was a youth playtesting, and we did that with Coder Dojo, and that worked out great. They already had the network. We were able to leverage that, and we came in with the content and some of the brand, and so it was very successful. So what's next? All of these projects that were built will be included in our sort of summer campaign launch on Thimble and on the WebMaker site. So we're working with everybody to finalize these over the next week or so, and building in some of the stuff we've learned into Thimble, and then definitely in either the next phase or some relatively short in the future phase of Thimble on the WebMaker site, we want to build in the ability for the community to very easily submit missions or projects that they've made on their own. And that's been on the roadmap, but definitely, you know, based on what we saw this week, we know that that's a top priority. So that's probably enough for me. I certainly encourage you guys to click through the links and check this out. And there's a couple questions here. Is all of this tweetable? Jess is saying she would wait until the partner projects are done. So most of them are going to be done by the end of this week. It's code freeze June 1st. personally, I would say it's fine to talk about the event. I'm certainly going to blog post about it, but in terms of maybe featuring specific partner content, we probably would wait in a week to feature specific stuff. But talking about the event is definitely open as of now.
Cool. So focus more the documentation right now on the event as opposed to highlighting the partner projects.
Exactly. Yep. And yep. You can certainly link to the project page now, but yeah, focus on the event level. And then at the end of this week or early next week, we can kind of do some pushes about specific things like the London Zoo project or whatever.
Very cool. And I mean, to Mark's earlier point that, you know, the big takeaway was people really can make something cool with ThimbleFast. Was there one like specific example that stood out? I know in line, let's see, 234, there's an Etherpad with stuff that kids made. Was there one of those that kind of stood out for people?
Sure. I'll pass that over to Jeff, maybe for those highlights.
Okay. Yeah, so I would definitely, I'm sorry, like, someone's mowing their lawn. I would say, basically, if you take a look at any of the ones on line 9 to 12, there are by this young boy named Hamza, who is 7 years old, and he immediately was able to pack them. I would say the zoo one is the most beautiful and instantaneous. Kids were in love with the fact that they could mix and match animals and make their own new animals. That was the most visual and beautiful one to see happen in action. I think Chloe could attest, but I think it took maybe 20 minutes, and only because the kids were taking a long time really sharpening their writing skills on that one, and they were, you know, writing the stories about their new created animals. So it was very interesting.
Very cool. So when I click on Hamza's creation in line 9 there, this is the London Zoo project where he's able to basically make a web page about his own animal.
Yeah.
Cool. Very cool. Thanks, guys. Any questions for this group on London Learn Jam and what's next? Very cool stuff. The partner projects looked really fantastic.
I would also just give a shout out and thanks to Andrew for helping out and being our hacker in residence. It was really great to have him on board.
Yep. Andrew is great. And also, like, super shout outs to the learning group and Chloe and Jess and Michelle Thorne, John Bevan. The event it just really turned out to be a really, like, rockin' event, and that's all because of the stuff that you guys did. So very cool.
So Brett's just asking what the interface looks like for the London Zoo project. So that's all under line 199 on that wiki, Brett. Maybe others have the same question. So all the results under results. So all those projects and all of those links are there on line 199 on that wiki. Cool. Let's push ahead. And this is more on Summer Coke Party. Ben Simon, do you want to start us off? Looks like we've got approximately 100 events on the event platform.
Yeah, am I coming through?
Yep.
All right. Yeah, it looks like we've got about 100 events. We can't get a precise count right now because of the way that Blue State talks to the back end of Django stuff, but a patch is being put in by the master team Ross this week, and so we should have more accurate ones going forward. But either way, 100 already is pretty awesome. So kudos to everyone who's already put stuff in, and also a lot of the partners have been good about getting stuff in already. And so it's a really promising start on that front. The two other sort of updates on host stuff is that sort of broad-based host recruitment is going to begin in earnest this week. We're going to be in the Firefox and You newsletter tomorrow with host asks to their many millions of people. And then we'll also be emailing our own list this week with the same ask, and partners are going to start making some more pushes. And the other thing is to make another request to get your own Mozilla events in there. And please let me or Michelle know when you do, and we can tag them as official, which gets them a fancy checkbox in the event search when people go. So it sort of looks like the Twitter verified checkbox type thing. And it's basically a way for us to signal, like, this is a legit full-on Mozilla thing, and, like, we vouch for this event, as opposed to the others, which are just, like, volunteer-led and are great, but are sort of have a slightly smaller degree of, like, our own skin in the game with what happens if bad things go wrong, and also how much you vouch for the hosts and stuff. And so if there's, like, high-level volunteers in your projects who are hosting events, we can also tag those as official. It's sort of like, do we vouch for this event and this host?
Cool. And, Ben, can I ask a dumb question? Is there, like, a global, like, map view of all events in the system?
There is not. That's filed as a feature request, and don't know if it's on the roadmap for the next release or the one after, but it's filed. It is filed already.
Very cool. So other than a reminder to this group to get their events onto the platform if they haven't already, is there any other specific asks or help you're looking for right now, Ben?
Make plans to host your own event if you haven't already on the weekend, and hopefully help out with support as well. I think there will be some more on that, on the specifics of that from Ryan either today or later this week.
Today.
All right, today.
Today. Cool. So get your Mozilla events in, make plans for the tournament, and tell your friends. That's kind of the 1, 2, 3.
And then make plans to, like, help with support stuff. But there'll be more coming on that later.
Cool. And Jeff and Chloe, did you have anything more you wanted to add on learning project beta testing?
Nothing major. We just really wanted to ask people to join us for our debrief call on Thursday, just 2 days away. Basically, we've done 18 projects to date, which includes the partner projects that we were talking about just now, the London Learning Jam, and I know there's about 4 more in conjunction with the Hive NYC project, as well as some of the projects like the Tumblr project. So we really want to take this time. We've done 7 in-person playtests, which is no small feat, as well as having a handful of virtual playtesters. And we want to just use this moment to iterate while we can. We've been doing constant iteration and changing. I think I know the projects from the Web Arcade have been changed about 3 different times just to respond to different kinds of feedback that we've been receiving. But it would really be great to hear overall, you know, kind of what's working, what's not working, and how we can improve moving forward. So I'd love to invite everyone to join us on Thursday if you have some time to help us with that.
Cool, and I see a bunch of new projects in there like Bakery Bash, Avatar-O-Matic, and a couple others. Cool, so you're looking for people to join your call on Thursday and just keep kicking the tire on these beta projects?
Yes, definitely.
Cool. Sounds good. Any questions on that before we push ahead to Michelle to talk about the Mozilla Festival? Question coming in on 273. Can we promote beta testing to Facebook and Twitter? And I think the answer is yes.
Yes.
We've been doing that for a while now.
Mm-hmm.
Cool. All right, well, let's push ahead. And Michelle Thorne, you're going to tell us about Mozilla Festival.
Yeah, MozFest. So we launch one thing and then we start talking about the next. So just not to rest on our laurels. No, we're really excited. We just spent a few days in London and things are falling into place for the next Mozilla Festival. In case you don't know, it'll be November 9th through 11th in London, in the same college that we were last year in Ravensbourne. And what we're working on in this phase is first kind of top level goal setting. So what do we want to achieve with this festival? How do we build on the arc that we've started with the first two? And how can we start planning sessions, activities, partnerships around those goals? So I'd like to invite you just to take a moment to follow along with me. I started a wiki. You can go there on line 283. And I'll first just talk about the top-level goals, and then a number of people here are already slated on some activities at the festival, and I've spoken to them to you one-on-one, but also just wanted to invite a conversation around those particular sessions, or if you see gaps, how you'd like to get involved. So first to the main point. So we've been thinking about what's the theme or how do we talk about the festival this year. And I think with the strands that we have building on learning, which we started in Barcelona, media exploration, which we had last year, and now inquiries into gaming and even some physical web making, and the idea of web makers overall, we're exploring this theme of making freedom in the web, which is a theme that I'd love you also to hack on or think about, like, does it sit right? Does it explain well what we're trying to achieve? Just kind of toss that out there. And then looking at kind of the top level goals, I think still at the heart of what we're doing, it's about making and learning. So having lots of sessions that are around, you know, less tech, less yak, more hack. So making things with the tools that we're developing, like Popcorn Maker and Thimbl. New tools that others have that are complementary to our goals. Learning who's building what, learning different skills with those tools, and charting ways for us to build new ways to support other types of skills not yet covered. And I think a new thing that's thrown here in the mix is this long view, so future casting. So Mark has some thoughts around how we can imagine learning and making in 100 years, what does the future of what we're building look like? You know, if you think of the scouting movement or science as a societal endeavor, those are long shots, long bets that have taken fruit and really have changed the way societies work. So how can we think about that as applied to making freedom in the web? So designing stuff, fueling, and then what I think is an important aspect is building this leadership circle, so really fueling leaders, helping them achieve what they want, and helping them be connected with one another. So we have that strong leadership group, and the festival can be a platform to enable those people to find each other and chart the way forward. So that's kind of the big mouthful of some of our top-level goals. And I'd just like to ask folks on the call to take a look at the wiki because some of your names are on session proposals there. If they are, take a look at the little descriptions, like one sentence. Are you happy with it? If you are, we'll leave it. If not, you can ping me or you can edit it directly on the wiki. And if you're not, if your name's not on there and you would like to do something, you can also just shoot a line on the Etherpad or email me, michelle@missoulafoundation.org, and we can talk it through. So the deadline for this first cut is just by Friday because we'd like to prepare some stuff for the board meeting. But of course, it's a rolling process. So if you don't have an idea fully formed by Friday, there's still definitely time. But if you want to get it into the mix, please ping before then. All right, so I'll stop talking and read the Etherpad. Who is the target audience? That was a good question. I think we'll break it down again to this, one-third educators, one-third developers, designers, mix of good skill sets to help us build these things. I think youth, we want to be a much stronger focus. Maybe I'll be so bold as to say one-third youth. In the mix. Um, And I think this year also to be more active in recruiting people who've been at the previous festival, so really building on the momentum we started at other festivals and bringing them back and creating a sense of tradition and reunion. Right.
Cool. And Mark just underlined the importance of getting feedback into your wiki this week, Michelle. Like, is there a specific area where you'd like people to focus?
So the things that have people's names next to them, so we've kind of slotted in some proposed sessions around people's programs. So that's one thing that I just encourage everyone to have a look at. And then if you're not there but want to do something, to add a one-line pitch.
And it's Mark here. Maybe just let me add it. I mean, I think there's lots and lots of time to still add stuff after this week. But I think for everybody who is in the core WebMaker team, you guys are all well aware of the fact that the festival is sort of the pinnacle of the year, or the kind of place where we want to show off what we've done. So we will be discussing what the festival program is with the board on June 13. If you are doing one of the core WebMaker projects and you haven't got a sentence in there that describes the kind of thing you would like to do at the festival, you need to get it in this week, which is really just a sentence. Because we want to be able to kind of paint the picture of everything that's going to happen. So I think that's the core ask is, you're working on Popcorn, or you're working on Hive, or you're working on anything else that we talk about regularly on these calls, make sure there's at least one sentence in there that reflects the kind of thing that you're hoping to do.
Cool. So I see Forrest already has a proposal, which is awesome. Web apps for hackability. Access for children. Oh, that's a good question. So we have clearance from Raymond's Board now to allow youth into the whole building. There won't be any restrictions. They will have to be with guardians, but we don't have to have just the zoned off youth section, although we might have some youth-specific areas still. So yes. Cool. Well, I'll let you guys have a think about it, and please also ping me if you have ideas and aren't quite sure yet how to formulate them or where they fit. I'm happy to talk it through. Thanks.
Very cool. Thanks, Michelle. All right. Well, we're just about coming to the end of the agenda. I'm just looking at the nonverbal updates in line 320. June 2nd is emoticon. You can have a look at blog posts in line 324. From the Hive folks. You can learn more about emoticon and why it will make you smile. And let's see, a nice report back from Greg on software carpentry. Almost 400 learners in 4 months. So I encourage you to have a look at Greg's report back in line 327. And line 345, for this coming Mozilla All Hands meeting on Monday, June 4th, really hoping that we can continue with the momentum that Mark started by presenting WebMaker and the Summer Code Party in the last All Hands meeting. There wasn't one yesterday because it was a holiday. So I got actually a lot of interest from Mozillians after that presentation who want to participate in Summer Code Party and are maybe a little unsure of how exactly. So I'm wondering if somebody could volunteer to do a really quick lightning presentation on Monday, just kind of showing off the new event site, showing how easy it is to find or host your own event, and really just kind of underscore ways that Mozillians can get involved. So Ben Simon, I've seen the pad. I know you're already kind of doing some of that with Bay Area folks. Maybe we can chat offline about whether we can volunteer you to do a kind of follow-up lightning presentation on Monday, if that would work for you. And I think that's about it. Let's have a quick look at the calendar. Talked about emoticon. Michelle Levesque, I don't know if you want to talk about the instructor community conference that's happening in the San Francisco office June 2nd. star 7 to unmute.
I was just saying in the chat that it's been postponed, so it's not happening on June 2nd.
Oh, that's good to know. Cool. So, and the new date is pending?
Yeah, there's not a firm new date yet.
Cool. And otherwise, I'll just encourage people to take a look at the Eventbrite page for the Night Mozilla MIT Story and Algorithm Hack Day. Happening on June 16th and 17th. I'll just put it in the Ether chat. Any final items or questions before we wrap up? Going once? Going twice? All right, well, thanks for a great call, everybody. We'll talk to you all next week. Bye, everyone. Hey, Erin, are we doing the summer campaign call?
Yeah. Yep.
So if you're part of the summer campaign call, you can just hang out. We'll resume in a minute or so.
And while I'm mute.
Thank you. Please stand by.